Imagine you're chilling at home, enjoying the view, and suddenly smoke is rising in front of you. You're in a high-rise apartment and a fire is raging below. How much danger are you in?
As a person who worries about safety, I used to think everything would burn down like a house, but that isn't true. In fact, high-rise apartments are actually much safer and have incredible engineering that protects you, like this smoke vent that I never knew keeps the air clean as you escape during a fire. But sometimes, taking these stairs is a bad choice that can kill you, and it would have been safer to wait inside for rescue. Confusing, right? My name is Andrew, and let's uncover how the safety engineering in high-rises means it's often safe to do both. I'll also show you how things went wrong in past disasters, and when choosing to stay or leave might be the difference between life or death. Let's get into it. Before we dive deeper, I'd thank the sponsor of today's video, Vessi. And I've been wearing their shoes long before they came to sponsor a video. So it's kind of cool, and their shoes fit perfectly with my need to own less but more versatile stuff. First off, they look good, which gives me a nice feeling when I'm meeting other people. They're also comfortable, which is great if you need to run around the city like I did to make this video. I also hate wet socks, and with Vessi's, that stopped being an issue as they're 100% waterproof, as they're made using Dymatex, which is a material that's cool and breathable when it's hot, and during the winter, it keeps my toes warm, which is amazing as I get cold feet really easily. And they kind of do it all, and I've been wearing this pair for the last 2 years, and the new ones feel better because Vessi upgraded the soles so they're more supportive, and I feel more comfortable being athletic, like in the cityscape, which I love for its clean style and light weight. And I'm also a fan of the weekend for that classic white sneaker look that I can easily keep clean as it can be thrown into the washing machine. They have a ton of other styles, and if you're looking for a do-everything urban shoe, check them out in the link below, Vessi.com, and use my code AndrewLamb for $25 off. Now let's dive back into our story of how we stop buildings from burning down.
Fires used to scour cities, like the burning of Rome in 64 AD, or the Great Fire of London in 1666, which destroyed huge areas as flames easily spread between closely packed wooden buildings. Eventually, government said no more and required fireproof materials like stone and slate in downtown areas. Later, shared walls were to be built of a certain thickness and quality to contain fires even more. This safety idea continued into modern high-rises, which are really just stacked houses, and is known as compartmentation today. It works by using fire-resistant walls and floors to protect every unit by locking flames and smoke inside, or forming a sanctuary for residents to shelter in while the fire is being extinguished.
High-rises require the highest level of fire protection due to the risk of death, which is why reinforced concrete is often used.
In Toronto, the floors and supporting walls must have 2 hours of fire resistance, which is the minimum it must last under a flame test before letting anything through or collapsing. Fire can also pass through holes drilled for water and other connections, so a special fire-stopping material is applied to seal the opening. That's this red stuff surrounding pipes you probably never noticed in buildings, and all of this engineering is to stop fire from crashing in and burning you alive.
In 2010, this protection saved many lives during the worst Canadian hoarding fire in the building behind me.
A fire broke out at Canada's largest social housing complex 2 years ago. Flames and smoke filled the skies during the supper hour.
A recent report by the Toronto Star revealed how a room filled with paper turned into a flamethrower by the wind. Despite its fury, residents who were trapped in their units beside and across the room on fire survived. Others successfully escaped.
Miraculously, no one died, and only 3 people had serious injuries due to the way this building and other high-rises were designed.
By the way, a high-rise in Toronto is defined as a building above 7 stories, but that will change based on where you live.
Smaller buildings like these require less protection, and here in Toronto, that's 1 hour of fire resistance. These can also be built using combustible materials like wood, and there's a lot of it. You might wonder, is this safe? The short answer is yes, but in a different way, as this design assumes people can escape quickly, or firefighters can bring equipment to rescue residents from the outside. But it's riskier if you had to shelter in place, as fire is more likely to spread, especially in older buildings.
Regardless of size, most people die when smoke can get into the staircase, cutting off the exit and filling the rest of the building, suffocating people inside. This bothered me, as I have friends and family who live in high-rises, so I dug further and discovered most failures weren't from walls or floors, but the fire doors that protect every unit and staircase in the building. That means each apartment door is special, but I didn't understand their importance until I saw this demo. The safety company UL set up a mock home, and then set a fire in the living room, which connected to two bedrooms, one with the door open, the other closed. After extinguishing the fire, they dropped the front wall, revealing these shocking differences. Without the door, you would have been smothered in your sleep, and this is just a basic interior door you would find in your home. Fire doors are built better, and must survive testing that exposes them to high heat, anywhere from 20 minutes to this 3-hour door at 1000 degrees Celsius, followed by a hose stream test to verify its structural integrity.
If you take a look at your fire door, all approved models have a special label applied that tells you how long it's certified to last and that has the right construction and hardware. Let's see why that matters.
This is a test with three identical 30-minute fire doors, but two of them are using the wrong parts. Try to guess which ones. Once the test starts, you won't have to wait long as a window shatters at the 4-minute mark as regular glass was installed. Flames are shooting out, and they have to close up this clearly failed door. Same thing a minute later, with the regular letterbox melting away, and they seal it up. Nothing happens for a while, but then flames are seen at 18 minutes, and that's because a protective strip around the door is missing. This strip, when heated, would swell to protect the edges, and without it, this wooden door lost 50% of its rated life, and has failed, resulting in a ton of smoke spewing out. In comparison, the middle door lasts the full 30 minutes as it has the right hardware that most people don't know exists. But it's not just construction that matters. Fire doors need to securely latch, which means you can't just push it open. The surprising reason is that fires don't just produce heat, but also air pressure, which can blow open a door. But that doesn't matter if the door isn't shut, and that's where an automatic closing device or these spring-loaded hinges become crucial. If these fail, it can cause a disaster, which is what happened during the 2022 Bronx apartment fire.
The entire building from ground floor to roof filled with heavy smoke, an unusual sight even for firefighters. And those firefighters found victims on every floor of that building, on stairwells, all overcome by smoke.
But you couldn't see anything?
Nothing.
What was that like?
Traumatizing.
The New York Times did some amazing journalism and showed how the fire started in a third-story apartment. The occupants ran out, but the fire door didn't close, which let smoke pour into the hallway, go up the stairs, and into many other levels because those doors also didn't work. 17 people were killed, including a family who collapsed in the stairs. In the aftermath, one senior fire official cautioned against leaving.
We do recommend in high-rise fireproof buildings that people should shelter in place, and it's safer to be in your apartment than to venture out and try to get down the stairs, sometimes into a much more dangerous situation.
That's normally good advice, but staying might not have saved them, as several people from their floor still died in their units. I found it sad how a lack of maintenance caused so much suffering, but hopefully better enforcement will stop this from happening again.
What's also unfortunate is this tragedy could have been prevented if they had this one piece of technology. The fire sprinkler, and I think there's a lot of misplaced fear about them.
Thanks to movies and TV, many people think a little smoke or pulling the fire alarm will set them all off, but that's not the way it works. Instead, most sprinklers have a glass bulb that needs to be heated to a certain temperature, expanding the fluid inside until it explodes, releasing water. When a sprinkler is activated, they are great at stopping or slowing a fire, giving you another layer of life-saving protection. For example, in the Bronx fire, the fire doors failing wouldn't matter if there was no fire. As well, sprinklers have gotten better since their invention in 1874 when sprinklers used a perforated cap that shot chunky streams of water. Today, most sprinklers spray water more evenly and points downwards, which controls fire better. Home sprinklers have a different design that's focused on life safety, with a thinner glass bulb that responds to heat faster and a diffuser with more fins compared to the office version. This changes the spray pattern, and home sprinklers shoot water higher, wetting the walls, and there are good reasons for this. Compared to offices, most homes have combustible materials next to walls like sofas and drapes, and you want to make sure water reaches them. As well, this higher spray pattern cools down the hot gas layer that forms on top of fires, which slows or stops flashover, which is when the air and materials inside the room become hot enough to ignite. That's especially important today, as our use of synthetic materials means fires burn faster, hotter, and dirtier compared to natural fibers from 50 years ago, which reduces your time to escape. When I looked through the list of major fires, the ones with many deaths lacked sprinklers because they were built before they were required. Today, most new high-rises require them, which reduces your chance of death by 80% and is one of the most important safety systems today.
Even with sprinklers, you need to know if a fire is raging floors below, and that's where smoke and heat detectors like the one above me are used. And in modern buildings are connected to sophisticated fire alarm systems, which have conditions to trigger a full building evacuation.
Let's pretend that happened, so we can see the engineering that protects your escape.
If we're gonna leave, the best time is right away. Let's get out of here.
Right now, you'd be really hoping the air is clear, and compartmentation does a lot of heavy lifting, but it can't do it all. In this stairwell, there's something that helps, and it's hidden behind this ordinary looking vent. It's called a smoke control system, and during a fire, powerful fans are activated to drive air through vents into the staircase, creating an area of high pressure that keeps smoke away. But the smoke has to go somewhere, and this vent in the hallway is critical. It's connected to a fan on the roof, which turns on and sucks out the smoke. The vents on other floors close to prevent leaks and maximize suction. This smoke control system is one of many designs, and it might not even exist in older buildings. Some countries, like Japan, allow open staircases and smoke naturally drifts away. As we get near the exit, we all assume it's easy to get through the door, but that wasn't always true. It took a major disaster before a few deadly obstacles were removed. It's 1903, and that day, the Iroquois Theater was beyond packed. A fire raged out of control, consuming the stage. Panicked patrons soon found themselves lost in a maze of unfamiliar pathways and trapped behind gated stairs. Some doors swung inwards, and the crush of the crowd made it difficult or impossible to open. These and other obstacles contributed to over 600 people dying that day and struck a nerve with two inventors who created and patented the first crash bar. Today, these are so universal, I bet every one of you have used one, regardless of the country you're watching this video from. The key is that a crash bar opens even when a mob of panicked people fall on it, and it won't jam on like knobs or levers. During a fire, this feature would be really important as you flee the building with other people. But hold on, many fire departments don't want you to run down the stairs, and there are good reasons why. For example, New York City has notices that tell residents if their building is non-combustible and to stay inside unless conditions become dangerous. In fact, the entire United Kingdom is educated on this.
You are usually safer staying in your own flat, unless heat or smoke is affecting you. Stay put and call 999.
It can save your life, but you stop being the star of the show, and now your survival depends on how quickly firefighters can get to your apartment and extinguish the fire. Your building helps by having elements like fire lanes to speed up their work, and I think two features are especially important. The first is something you've often used, an elevator. And during a fire, these are transformed into a shuttle for equipment and people to form an operating base below the floor of the fire. However, older elevators were unreliable and firefighters would be forced to walk and lug heavy equipment like air bottles, which is exhausting and time-consuming. Laws were passed to upgrade elevators, and this graphic shows how they changed in the UK from 1971 to 1992, adding things like backup power and fire resistance. Many of these features are shared worldwide, like having bigger sizes and higher weight capacities to help evacuate residents. As well, special panels at the lobby and inside the elevator have been added to allow firefighters to gain control of them, which also prevents residents from taking them to their deaths. Assuming they work, this allows them to quickly set up the hoses they'll need, and here, they'll face the next challenge, getting water. You see, fire hoses can use up to 150 gallons per minute, 12 times what a garden hose uses. And unlike house fires, they can't just run it outside and hook it up to a fire hydrant. That's why every high-rise has special infrastructure called standpipes or fire mains that run up the height of the building. These can be seen next to or inside the stairwell where firefighters will connect their hoses to. But sometimes, there's not enough water pressure, and they use fire trucks to pump water into the building. That's where this comes in handy, the FDC, Fire Department Connection. And these are found outside every high-rise and connect directly to the standpipes inside, forming a link from the hydrant to the pump truck and into the building. Once the water is flowing and firefighters are ready, they'll start from the staircase and use the protection of the fire door to advance and extinguish the flames. You might notice that the same protections that keep firefighters safe also keep you safe and allow them to do their job faster.
Hopefully, you can now see that when a high-rise has the right engineering and it's working correctly, that you'll be safe whether you leave or stay. Learning about this made me feel better, especially as I used to think these buildings were dangerous. Here's my theory on why. The media downplays successful stories and sensationalizes tragic fires to get your attention, just like plane crashes, when the actual risk is the opposite. Houses have become more dangerous over the last 40 years, and high-rises much safer, but that doesn't feel like it's true if you watch the news. It's also rare to see reports on new technology, like special elevators that can be used during fires and other emergencies to evacuate people, which can be faster than stairs, and for less mobile occupants, can be life-saving. The future looks great.
Thanks for joining me on this journey. I'll link detailed safety guides below if you want the nitty-gritty on what you can do during a fire. I'll also include links to the most fascinating engineering and firefighting resources I've used to make this video. You might have noticed it's been a while since my last video, and that's because I was trying to improve my storytelling and threw away a lot of bad content as a result. The next video will be faster. Subscribe if you want more videos on surprising design that'll help you find wonder in our world. And if you want to help support me in creating this type of content, check out our sponsor, Vessi. They make really versatile shoes that I've been wearing for a while. Or if you want to give directly, the super thanks button is below. Thanks, and I'll see you next time with more innovative designs.